Thank you, Peg. It's great to be here. I'm reading from my novel, Junction, Utah. Thanks for the great introduction. And it takes place in part on the Green River, which is on the cover. And on the river, as well as I think in other parts of society, we have this term for when there's a lot of mistakes that happen all in the same place. A cluster something. I'm going to read a passage narrated by 20-something river guide Madeline Cruz, which might be considered a cluster something. So she's following her former boyfriend, Rick, also a river guide, into a huge, crashing, flooding maelstrom of a rapids called Worm Springs. Rick pushed his boatload from shore. I followed, leaving a strategic amount of space between us. Midstream, he lined up for the run. From upstream, I saw his new girlfriend, Cookie, hunkered in the very nose of his raft in front of his passengers. They all faced the waves ahead. Everything seemed in order until Cookie grabbed the bow line and stood up. Rick, it seemed, was urging her up to his front too, coaching her, it seemed, in the art of becoming a human bowsprit. Meanwhile, he neglected his entrance. He was heading left, lining up for crashing, thrashing, Warm Springs Hole. His raft lingered at the very lip of the rapids, caught in the pause before the fall. That moment is a hummingbird moment, a wordless hovering, a short break before plunging down. In that tiny slice of time, Rick seemed to realize he was off the mark. He pulled hard to angle right, throwing Cookie off balance. She fell from the bow, her legs splayed in the air. Rick's raft dropped out of sight. An instant later, it swept up the first wave, his people, in disarray, fallen in a jumble to the floor of his raft. Everyone but Rick. He maintained his seat, pushing the boat up the second wave, barely inching to the watery summit. No more time for rubbernecking. I sat up straight, lined my left tube where I wanted it, and held us there. Right on, nearer to shore than Rick had been, but not so close we'd bump on the rocky bank. We rushed up the first hill of water. My passengers screamed with roller coaster hysteria. No sooner had we crested and slipped over the top than the entire family in my bow turned to me. They were pointing downstream, their eyes popping. "They're over," shouted the father. "Damn, Rick must have flipped." So Madeline proceeds to run the rapid with no problem. And while she is aware that Rick's raft is overturned downstream, she has this moment of introspection. Moments of triumph on the river are often balanced by the practical. Sometimes you survive a monster run, the need to get to shore immediately, while you keep an eye downstream and kick a pop door back into place. Sometimes, too, you have to save someone's life and stay as calm as pond water, as you do. That last part is my forte. Maybe I'm not mega strong at the oars like they say my dad was. And I don't bother nurturing people like my mom would, even when I'm the only woman on a river crew, and they look to me for care. No, my claim to fame is that when things go wrong, all I think about is coming to the rescue. I'll focus on the other guy, get out of my body. So into life-saving, I could be Supergirl, or Achilles without the heel. I'll burst out from under a flipped raft in fast or rocky water, looking to save any swimmer and shove the boat to shore, so we can ride it quick before it's lost. Come to find out, though, not all people like being saved. I learned that the hard way. One time when I was still greener at guiding than a river willow, I was on a three-raft float trip on the American River, just drifting into the easy water near Gold Discovery Park. The hot midsummer air had brought out the crowds. Looking for the river to cool them, families flowed together into a seamless horde that streamed from shore in inner tubes, kayaks, paddle rafts, anything that floated. It was a sort of Ganges River scene, one we were hoping to bypass. Well, out of this crowd, two neophytes in matching camouflage cargo pants launched an aluminum canoe just ahead of me. At a glance, I could tell their canoe belonged on a lake, not a river. The two guys didn't realize it, though, and they didn't last long. Within minutes, they'd wrapped on the big downstream boulder in Old Scary Rapids. Only one of the paddlers stayed with the boat. The other washed ashore. I turned my attention to the maroon form. He looked small standing there, with his hands clasping the waistband of his pants. I didn't stop to chat. I just lined up on the tongue of the rapids, aimed for the little pocket eddy to the right of the boulder, and tied to an alder. I called to him. Of course, he dropped his paddle and lost his sunglasses, and his eyes shone with big, bulgy fear. Tossing him a line, I pointed to the canoe crossbar. He tied it up. I hitched the other end to my raft. I jumped back to my rowing seat and pulled for the current. The river swept me downstream, dislodging the highly inappropriate craft and towing it behind. I cheered, triumphant. The rescued guy held to the canoe, full of water though it was, and drifted in his life jacket. He seemed calmer. To be kind, I vowed to say nothing about his one-armed dog paddle. But no sooner had we landed than he turned on me. You're just plain brave, aren't you? My eyebrows shot up. That's right, said his friend. He coughed, soggy from the swim. The rescued guy narrowed his formerly popping fish eyes. You're just one tough chick. Sacagawea and tinnies, born too late. While I was still breathing hard from roaring and free, I felt my blood race. What did he know about toughness? About losing your dad before you're even born? About having just a mom and one who's fighting a life-threatening illness at that? If the rescued guy knew toughness, I wouldn't have had to bail him out. I walked away hotter than jalapenos, my mind full of curses, I didn't say. My neck burned knowing they were probably glaring at the rear of the skinny, long-legged, 20-something woman guy whose ponytail bikini top and Converse high tops. Shouted, neighborhood babysitter, not whitewater goddess. Nonetheless, I pulled out their burning bacon. Now Rick was the one in trouble. Again, I didn't hesitate. My boat was moving fast, still riding momentum from the rapids. His raft drifted in the slower water below Warm Springs Rapids. His passengers knelt on the overturned boat, survivors on a great island of rubber. That is, all but one. Maybe 50 yards ahead, Cookie floated alone, just a tiny beam in an icy, swift river. Rick pointed downstream with the exaggerated motion that said, swimmer. He could have been a neon sign, one arm waving, showing me, go that way, man. You are needed down there. Thank you.